Now in this video, we start discussing about the Carnot steam vapor cycle. So this is how a Carnot steam vapor cycle looks like, which is practically the same which was the introduction video on the steam vapor cycle. So you have a boiler in which you have some heat input, and then it goes into the turbine. Turbine expands the steam and in return gives us some turbine work, which is used to run some auxiliary unit. Now from turbine, the low pressure condensate steam is taken into condenser, where it loses heat to the atmosphere or to the cooling medium. This condensate is then taken into the compressor, which is basically an energy consuming device. So we put some work into it, which is also called the pump work or the pumping work, and this goes back into the boiler. So there are three graphs you need to understand for each power cycle or each vapor power cycle that we do. The first one is the PV plot, then TS, and then HS. Okay, HS is also called the Mollier chart. So let's first of all write down the processes that happen in this cycle. 1 to 2, this is reversible adiabatic, so this becomes isentropic, reversible adiabatic expansion, reversible adiabatic expansion, so it has some work output. 2 to 3, this is controlled condensation, so we keep the pressure almost same, so I would say isobaric. Okay, isobaric heat rejection. Okay, we'll discuss these three diagrams one by one. Then 3 to 4, this is reversible adiabatic work input. Okay. And then 4 to 1 is basically isobaric or controlled heat addition. Okay. So if you look at these diagrams now, there are two temperature limits and two pressure limits under which this cycle is working. So the first, let's talk about temperature. So it operates between TH and TL. Okay. 1 to 2, your pressure in the turbine inlet is P1 and the turbine outlet is P2. Okay. So your pressure falls from 1 to 2 and temperature falls from TH to TL, and the process followed is a reversible adiabatic expansion from 1 to 2. If you plot this one onto the TS plot, this is a vertically straight line which shows that S1 is equal to S2, same entropy. Okay, and similarly on the HS plot, which shows S1 is equal to S2. Okay, then let's move to 2-3, which is isobaric heat rejection. So if you go from 2 to 3, you are working on the same pressure P2. And there is some heat rejection, means condensation takes place. So whatever heat that we lose is the latent heat at constant temperature also. So 2 to 3 is a isobaric, or you lose latent heat, so you remain at constant temperature. So this is 2 to 3, so you lose some heat from here, and this is some work output or turbine work. Okay. Then from 3 to 4 you have reversible adiabatic work input. So now 3 to 4 you are compressing it, you are pumping it. Okay, so this is 3 to 4, again it shows that the entropy at 3 and 4 is same. Okay, and similarly over here S3 is equal to S4, and the isobaric operation 2 to 3 is also evident over here, same pressure 2 to 3. Okay, now let's come to 4 to 1. It is isobaric heat addition. So 4 to 1 you put some heat into it, which is at same pressure. Okay, and this also shows same pressure. Okay, and this also shows same temperature as we are adding the latent heat, right? Now how much heat is added? Either you use the TS plot, okay, or you use the HS plot. If you use the HS plot, the amount of heat added would be the difference between these two enthalpies, H1 minus H4. Straight away get these values from the Mollier chart, and the amount of heat rejected would be the the difference between H3, H2 and H3. So either you can use this chart or you can use this chart, because the area below the TS chart is the heat interaction. Okay, so if I talk about the heat input, that is Qin, that is taking place at TH. So TH into S1 minus S4, you will have TH into S1 minus S4, or simply H1 minus H4. Okay, then Q out, this takes place at TL. So TL into S1 minus S4, because S2 is equal to S1 and S3 is equal to S4. So you have TL into S1 minus S4. So we keep these bracket terms to be the same. Now the net work output is also equal to the net work input or the net heat interaction, because this is running in a cycle. Okay, so this becomes TH minus TL into S1 minus S4. So this is the value for the net work output. Okay, now from here I can find out the efficiency of the cycle. So I'll have the thermal efficiency as, and for this Carnot cycle, net work upon Qin. Okay, this would be equal to TH minus TL into S1 minus S4 divided by TH into S1 minus S4. You can strike off the entropy differences, and the efficiency will now become this, which is again the old formula that we know of for all the Carnot processes, that is 1 minus TL by TH. Okay, so this is what we need to discuss in the Carnot vapor power cycle. I hope you understood the entire operation and these three plots very, very importantly. So now after understanding the Carnot vapor power cycle, let's go to the next video and talk about the Rankine vapor power cycle.